Good evening. I want to thank you for joining us tonight to commemorate International Holocaust Remembrance Day. Those few of you whom I don't know, Jean Zeldin, I'm the Executive Director of the Midwest Center for Holocaust Education. Outstanding. Most of us in this country are accustomed to Holocaust remembrance being tied to Yom HaShoah, a date on the Jewish calendar that falls somewhere April or May, depending. And it was that was established by the Israeli Knesset in 1953. But for many European countries, there was no prescribed date or organized activity for honoring the lives and memory of Holocaust victims. That changed on November 1st, 2005, when the UN General Assembly adopted a resolution designating January 27th as International Holocaust Remembrance Day. The date, which by design corresponds to the liberation of Auschwitz-Birkenau by the Soviets in 1945, is meant to honor the victims of Nazism on a more global scale. The same resolution supports the development of educational programs to remember the Holocaust and to prevent further genocide. Tomorrow's ceremony at the United Nations will include a tribute to Professor Elie Wiesel of blessed memory, Holocaust survivor, Nobel laureate, and United Nations Messenger of Peace, who passed away last July. This year's theme at the UN is Holocaust Remembrance, Educating for a Better Future. It highlights the universal dimension of Holocaust education as an appropriate platform for building respect for human rights, increasing understanding, and defending our common humanity. Resolution 60/7, as it's known, also rejects any form of Holocaust denial. And drawing from the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, it condemns all forms of religious intolerance, incitement, harassment, or violence against persons or communities based on ethnic origin or religious belief throughout the world. Furthermore, the resolution encourages member states of the UN to actively preserve sites that the Nazis used during the Final Solution, for example, killing centers, concentration camps, and prisons. Tonight, we'll have the unique opportunity to learn more about those sites from our speaker. Many of you read in early announcements about this program that MCHE was seeking funds to purchase the United States Holocaust Memorial's 7-volume series, Encyclopedia of the Camps and Ghettos, 1933 to 1945. It is my pleasure to say that we no longer need to do that and to recognize Jack and Pat Weed, who responded with a generous donation, making it possible for us to purchase the first 3 volumes. Pat's here with us tonight. Thank you, Pat. And although he could not be here tonight, our thanks also go to Stan Bushman for his special commitment to fund the purchase of volumes 4 through 7, which are still works in progress. We're also grateful to the White Theater Grantor Fund of the Jewish Community Foundation for underwriting the theater-related costs for tonight's program. And I also want to thank Arvin Zwick, who I called this morning to see if he could record this event for posterity. I woke up and heard how great Jeff was at the program last night. I said, okay, we have to record this. He spoke at KU last night. With that, I'm going to turn the program over to MCHE's public historian, Dr. Shelley Klein, who will introduce Dr. Burke.
Thank you, Jean. Thank all of you for coming out here on this January evening. A few years ago, I was engaging in one of my favorite weekend activities, reading the Sunday New York Times, and I came across an article that was entitled, "The Holocaust Just Got More Shocking." Now, at this point, I was a doctoral student, a bit of a skeptical doctoral student engaged in my own Holocaust research. And so when I read this title, "The Holocaust Just Got More Shocking," I thought, really? And then I began to read this article, which was about this incredible project attempting to document all the camps and ghettos in the Nazi system. This project at that point had uncovered 42,000 camps in the Nazi system, camps and ghettos. And so, yes, the Holocaust did just get more shocking. I'm sure that Dr. Megargee here tonight will talk a bit more about the implications of what those numbers mean and why this really is such a shocking number, and the implications are pretty astounding. So when my colleague, Jessica Rockhold, suggested that perhaps we look into Dr. Megargee for this evening's talk, I was thrilled. Dr. Geoffrey Megargee is the Senior Applied Research Scholar at the Mandel Center for Advanced Holocaust Studies at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum, where he is the project director and editor-in-chief for this encyclopedia project. The first volume appeared in 2009 and received a National Jewish Book Award and a Judaic Reference Award, among other distinctions. Dr. Megargee received his doctorate in military history from Ohio State University. His book, Inside Hitler's High Command, was the winner of the Society for Military History's 2001 Distinguished Book Award. He's also the author of War of Annihilations, Combat and Genocide on the Eastern Front, 1941, and a contributor to the West Point History of Warfare. Dr. Megargee is a member of the Department of Army Historical Advisory Subcommittee and is a member of the Department of Army Historical, and has served for the Society for Military History, is treasurer of the United States Commission on Military History, and is a presidential counselor for the National World War II Museum in New Orleans. He frequently lectures on Germany, World War II, and the Holocaust. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Dr. Geoffrey Megargee.
Thank you, Shelley. I want to thank the center for inviting me out to speak with you this evening, and thank all of you for coming. I really enjoy these opportunities to get out and talk about our work and inform people about what is admittedly not the cheeriest subject in the world. What I'm going to try to do tonight is to give you an overview of the camp and ghetto system as it evolved from 1933 to 1945. I have about 45 minutes to an hour's worth of material here, after which we'll have a better part of another hour, I think, for discussion, which is often the best part of these events. At least you don't have to listen to me for too long. I'm going to approach this task by asking and answering a series of common questions about the camp system. I think you'll find that some of the answers are not common. But I will go over the evolution of the system in general terms, but a strict narrative doesn't work here. I'll just warn you about this up front. I'm going to be, in a sense, hopping around from subject to subject. I'll try to make it clear. But it's really too complex a subject to tell as one storyline. Now, our first question is basic enough. How many camps were there? Well, you've just heard that, and I think it was in the publicity materials. So it's not quite the shock that it is for a lot of audiences. But I will tell you that when I just meet people and when I ask them, how many camps do you think there were, usually they'll say, oh, I don't know, 20, 50, 100. Some brave ones will say 1,000. And when I first came to the museum in January of 2000, the senior historian at the museum told me that I would be looking for somewhere between 5,000 and 7,000 sites. And I thought that was an astounding figure. But then we started to look, and the more we looked, the more we found. There were some camps that had been researched, but nobody ever put the numbers together before. There were other kinds of camps that just nobody had looked into or not thoroughly. Let me find my clicker here. And really what happened was, are we working? There we go, because I've got this upside down. This is one example of the kinds of results that we found. We still have a panel in the museum, which we will be revising, that mentions 400 ghettos. What you're looking at is a map of the ghettos in occupied Eastern Europe that we uncovered for volume 2 of the encyclopedia. And it may not look like it, but there are almost 1,100 ghettos on this map. So it was almost a threefold increase in what we were expecting. And that has been the pattern throughout. Our current figure for all types of camps and ghettos is actually now up to around 45,000. And I can tell you that that's a conservative figure. There were many thousands more that we're not counting for reasons I won't go into at the moment, but we can get into that in discussion if you're interested. And bear in mind that the ones that we are counting were of significant size and lasted for a significant period of time. We're not counting every place that just had one or two or 10 prisoners. Now, what kinds of camps were there, and how did they evolve? This is going to be a quick overview. The full reality is too complex to present here, but I'll cover the major developments for some of the main kinds of camps. We'll start with concentration camps, a familiar term, obviously. It was, at the time, and even by the Germans, a loosely applied term. But there was one category of camps that held this official designation most consistently. It was run by a branch of the SS called the Inspectorate of Concentration Camps. And it's had its start with what historians refer to as the early camps. There were about 110 of these set up by the SA, the SS, and the local police and civil authorities in 1933 on an ad hoc basis. Now, how ad hoc, you ask? Here are a couple of examples of early camps. The one on the left at a place called Achtumsand is a grounded barge near Bremen. And you can see they've just put fencing around the gunwales of the barge, they've made a few modifications, and they've thrown a bunch of prisoners in there. The one on the right at Nora is in a disused school. So really, any empty space they could find, they used. What they were trying to do was to lock up all the thousands, and ultimately about 10,000, political prisoners that were arrested after the Nazis came to power, and especially after the Reichstag fire in February of 33. There were too many to hold in normal prisons, and also the SA often had an interest in holding them outside of the normal judiciary system. For reasons you can imagine, these were mostly communists and socialists. So this system grew up, as I say, on this ad hoc basis. Now, in mid-1934, the SS under Heinrich Himmler begins to take over control of these early camps. They closed most of them. The ones they kept open, they reorganized using their own camp at Dachau as a model. From there, the number of camps rose gradually at first. And so by 1942, that is about halfway through the war, there were still only 11 main concentration camps, including some of the familiar names, Auschwitz, Buchenwald, Ravensbrück, Sachsenhausen. They were still holding political prisoners, but also common criminals, and eventually they would hold just about every category of prisoner whom the Germans incarcerated. Now here you see an aerial shot of Buchenwald. This is from just after liberation, actually. So you can get some idea of the scale of these main concentration camps. I mean, there were thousands of prisoners in here. Now, there's one thing in particular I want to point out about this. I'm gonna wander away from the microphone for a minute. I'll try to make myself heard. Let me point out first of all that at Buchenwald there was a sizable barracks complex for SS personnel who were undergoing training. And there was housing for higher-ranking SS officers who also had their families with them. And they were interested in having some recreational facilities for the families. So up here in this wood, this is the zoo that they had for the SS families to visit. Right here is the bear pit. Okay. So imagine to yourself, it's a Sunday afternoon, the SS or officers have their families out for a walk. They can visit the bear pit. They can turn around and look through the fence at the crematorium. Okay. It boggles the mind. you have to ask yourself, what were they telling their kids? Don't be bad, children, or you'll wind up in there. Bizarre way of dealing with the world. Okay. Now, the number of prisoners in the system rose gradually as well, from about 21,000 in August of 1939 to between 70 and 80,000 in the spring of 1942. And the character of the camps also changed as they began to fill up with foreign nationals, mostly Poles at first, naturally enough, but gradually including prisoners from all over Europe and even abroad. It's important to note that the SS concentration camps were not primarily an instrument for use against the Jews at this stage. There was an influx of a large number of Jews, many of whom went to Buchenwald, right after Kristallnacht, when many Jews were arrested and put into camps and basically blackmailed into leaving the country. But for the most part, through these early years, most Jews went into other parts of the terror system, especially ghettos and special forced labor camps for Jews, both of which I'll talk about. Now, we'll come back to the concentration camps in a bit. I want to cover a couple of parallel developments, one of which is the T4 and other so-called euthanasia sites. Now, T4 simply refers to the address of this program's headquarters in Berlin, Tiergartenstrasse 4. But eventually, there were about 100 sites established. We're still finding a few new ones for this program. I do want to point out that we use the term euthanasia carefully in this context. And when it's written in the literature, it almost always has quotation marks around it. This was not euthanasia as we debate it today. This had nothing to do with people with terminal diseases voluntarily ending their own lives. This was a program with victims. These were Germans who were children and adults who had mental or physical disabilities or congenital diseases and who were patients at hospitals and sanatoria. And the Nazis considered these to be useless mouths or lives unworthy of living. It was tied in very closely with the whole eugenics movement, which was also very popular over on this side of the Atlantic. Doctors would select these patients, and they would be gassed. There was no choice for them or their families. The families were given false death certificates indicating that they had died of some sort of illness. And the bodies would be cremated. Here you have the euthanasia facility at Hartheim. This is a clandestine photo taken by a local resident. You can see the smoke coming out of the crematorium. You weren't supposed to document these places. These were the first places in which the Germans developed gassing technology for use on humans. In this case, chemically produced carbon monoxide. Later on in the program, they also used lethal injection and starvation. The total number of victims was at least 200,000 and perhaps 300,000. The establishment of ghettos began in Poland in 1940 and accelerated in 1941 as the Germans overran those parts of the Soviet Union that had significant Jewish populations. Eventually, as you saw on the map earlier, there were over 1,100 of them, usually villages or defined residential areas in larger towns and cities, often that had been Jewish neighborhoods to begin with, where the Germans concentrated the Jews. There were some similarities among these places, and there were some orders for their establishment. But there was no central organization or set of rules, as there was with the concentration camps, for example. The goals for the ghettos were not clearly defined at first. They were really a provisional measure while the Germans figured out what they were supposed to do. There was some effort later on to foster starvation and disease as killing measures. And in most places, the Jews were put to work. But the ghettos were never identified as either primarily killing sites or work camps. But they would prove useful in concentrating and isolating the Jews and making them available for the measures that the Germans developed later. Now here you see the ghetto, and I'm probably going to mangle this pronunciation, but Kozienice in the Radom district of Poland, which existed from October 39 until September 27, 1942, when the remaining inhabitants were sent to Treblinka. Note the simple barbed wire barrier here. A lot of times when we think of ghettos, we think of places like Warsaw that had high brick walls around them. But in a lot of smaller locales, there would be a barrier as simple as this one, or sometimes, quite often, nothing at all. Just notice signs saying, if you're found outside of this area, you will be shot. Now, some ghettos were eliminated within a matter of days or weeks. Others lasted for months or even years. But eventually, almost all of their inhabitants were either shot en masse or sent to killing centers. Next, we come to forced labor camps for Jews in and out of Germany. And this is a category that hasn't gotten a whole lot of attention. There were about 1,900 of these, all told, in Germany and the occupied Eastern territories, under the administration of the SS or civil authorities. They often worked in tandem with the ghettos, that is, healthy prisoners would be taken out of ghettos and sent to these work camps, and then when they were too weak to work, they would be sent back to the ghettos. What you're seeing here is part of the forced labor camp for Jews at Poniatowa in the Lublin district of Poland. And then we come to the killing centers. These were places whose primary function was killing. That's how we define it. We find it's important to make this distinction, usually through the use of gas, carbon monoxide or cyanide. We tend to avoid the use of the term death camps, although I slip and use it every now and again, because that term gets used so broadly and applied to places such as Mauthausen or Bergen-Belsen, where admittedly many, many people died because of German cruelty, but places whose primary mission was not to kill. We find that the establishment of places whose mission was to kill is one basic difference between what the Nazis did and what so many other countries have done. The museum counts five of these places, at Chełmno, Belzec, Sobibor, Treblinka, and Auschwitz-Birkenau. Now, the first four of those you could call pure killing centers. That is, almost everyone who arrived was killed immediately upon arrival. At Auschwitz-Birkenau, on the other hand, there was a significant forced labor component. There were about 200,000 people living there at the system's height, and so you had selections when people would arrive, you know, as we're all familiar with. Now, there is an argument, a debate about Majdanek. There were people who were gassed at Majdanek. The historians at the Holocaust Museum have decided that it doesn't quite count as a dedicated killing center because it had a lot of other purposes throughout its history and some other complications that I won't get into here. It's sort of an academic argument, admittedly, especially for the people who died in the place, but I wanted to cover that. Now, the photo here is of crematorium number 3 at Auschwitz-Birkenau in the final stages of construction. By this time, the Germans had a very good idea of how to create killing facilities that were going to be maximally efficient. Now, the beginnings of the killing center system occurred in the spring and summer of 1941 as the SS began to systematically kill off certain categories of concentration camp prisoners. These were prisoners who had become too weak to work and Soviet POWs whom the Germans classified as politically or racially dangerous. And in this initial effort, the SS cooperated with the T4 euthanasia centers to kill somewhere between 10 and 20,000 prisoners by April of 1942. Now, by mid-1941, or at some point between there and the end of that year, the Nazis make the decision to kill all of the Jews of Europe, the final solution. There is no firm date for this. It was a gradual decision that involved a lot of give and take between Hitler, his senior leaders, and people in the field. But between then and early 1942, we can say that the killing program using gas chambers definitely begins. The construction of the killing centers takes place toward the end of 41. As a matter of fact, in September of 41, the SS at Auschwitz carry out their first experiments with a sort of ad hoc gas chamber that they created and using Soviet POWs as their subjects. By early 1942, that chamber was in full operation, and soon the Germans added other facilities at the associated camp of Birkenau. Chełmno began operations in December of 1941, Belzec, Sobibor, and Treblinka by the following summer. All told, the Germans murdered at least 2.7 million victims, mostly Jews, in or en route to the extermination camps. Labor camps. Again, we have a problematic term because most prisoners had to work no matter what kind of camp they were in. But there was a group of camps that was created expressly for labor. As early as 1940, Germans began getting people in other countries to work in German industry, business, and agriculture. Eventually, there were thousands of camps for foreign workers. We're still trying to nail down the numbers, but the total appears to be somewhere between 30 and 40,000. It's the largest group of camps that we're trying to catalog. What you see here is part of the camp associated with the Volkswagen factory at Wolfsburg in north central Germany. And you can see this doesn't look too bad. I mean, they've got some nice shrubberies and park benches and all that sort of thing. I suspect, strongly suspect, that this was a facility for skilled Western workers who were not treated nearly so bad, as badly as the Easterners were. And here we return to the SS concentration camp system, because the SS by now had figured out that they could make some money from their prisoners as well as getting work out of them. They started renting their prisoners, literally, to industrial concerns, starting with factories that were fairly close to the main concentration camps, and eventually building subcamps, a whole network of subcamps, at more distant industrial facilities. These were administered through the 20 or so main camps. In total, there were about 900 of these so-called subcamps, holding nearly 525,000 prisoners at their peak. And this was the point at which thousands of Jews were injected back into the concentration camp system in that last year or so of the war, so that their labor could be exploited before they died. And ironically, this is where many of the survivors came from, people who were sent out to these subcamps and managed to hang on until they were liberated. POW camps. These were in existence, logically enough, since the start of the war. They were run by the German military, the Wehrmacht. There were about 650 main POW camps, some of which were mobile, with subcamps running into the tens of thousands, more than the encyclopedia can cover, and there's hardly any data on them anyway. There were about 1.9 million POWs in Germany by August of 1944, and the Germans were using them very extensively for labor. This is Stalag Luft 4, a camp for air crew. That's what the Luft there designates, that was run by the Luftwaffe for Allied air crew, mostly Americans and British in this instance. This camp was in far northeast Germany, which is now part of Poland. And it, too, doesn't look too bad. I mean, at least they have buildings to live in. I want you to keep this image in your mind. We're going to come back to it. Okay, we've talked about killing centers, concentration camps, ghettos, labor camps, euthanasia sites, POW camps. These made up the largest part of the system, numerically. I want to take a quick look at some of the other categories to give you an idea of the kinds of variety that were involved. And this is one of the big things that we've discovered through doing the encyclopedia, is just how many different kinds of camps there were. We'll start with work education camps, Arbeitserziehungslager. There were roughly 120 of these. They started being formed in summer of 1941, and they were subordinate to the security police and security service of the SS. They held mostly foreign workers, but also Germans, for violations of labor discipline, such as refusing to work, or not working hard enough, in somebody's eyes, or refusing to give the Hitler salute at work. The idea was to put these people to work in a regulated environment for up to 8 weeks, and if that didn't work, the prisoner could be sent to a concentration camp. Now, a lot of you are probably wondering, okay, he's talking about camps. Why does he have a picture of a church up there? This is an indication of the extent to which the Germans used all kinds of facilities for their own purposes. This is the cloister at Breitenau in central Germany. What you can't tell is that half of this main church was walled off and used to hold these prisoners, while the front portion of the church, through the nave, was used for normal church services. The locals would come and have their church services there on Sunday morning, and on the other side of this wall would be these work education camp prisoners. Youth protection camps. The Nazis had a wonderful talent for euphemism, if nothing else. There were only three of these. They existed from the summer of 1940 on under the Reich Criminal Police Office, which in turn was part of the SS main office for security. This is where they sent juvenile delinquents, not all of their juvenile delinquents, but some of them. If you were acting up in school or committing, you know, minor crimes or listening to swing music or something like that, and you came to the attention of the proper authorities, you might wind up in one of these places. The idea was, you know, again, put these kids to hard labor, make them work, you'll straighten them out. You have to wonder how many parents went along with this idea. What you see here is the facility at Moringen. It was mostly in this main building here and along this row of houses here. And again, you see how the Germans incorporated a lot of these places into their population centers. I mean, there's nothing special separating this from the rest of this little town. Police detention camps, penal camps, and prisons. There were several hundred of these under both civil and military authorities. They held political prisoners, common criminals, hostages, civilians from occupied territories who had broken the rules, and Jews in transit to other facilities. The Germans also referred to them sometimes as concentration camps or transit camps or any one of several other designations. This particular one is the Gestapo prison in Cologne. I suspect it was a regular prison, and the Gestapo simply took it over. Now, within some of the larger concentration camps, the Germans set up brothels in which women were forced to work. Some brothels were also established for forced laborers. Now, at this point, I'm going to ask for a show of hands. How many of you have heard of the comfort women whom the Japanese army forced into sexual slavery? As I thought, most of you. Okay. Not many people realize that the Germans did exactly the same thing. The German army had about 500 brothels at the height of the system in various cities and towns throughout the occupied territories. The one you see here is in the French city of Brest. Note that the Germans have located the brothel in a synagogue, so they're sort of killing two birds with one stone, ideologically. The women who worked in these places might have violated some regulation and been arrested for that reason. They might have just been caught in a roundup. Some of them were sex workers already, but were forced by the Germans to work in these places for them. Scholars are now addressing this sort of formerly taboo subject to a greater extent. The fact is that sexual crimes were part and parcel of almost every aspect of the broader Nazi enterprise. Germanization facilities. These were special facilities in which the Germans kept Polish children who appeared to have valuable racial characteristics, you know, blonde hair, blue eyes, all that sort of thing. Some of these were orphans whom the Germans took out of orphanages. Some of them were simply kidnapped right off the street. They would be taken to these facilities, evaluated, and if they were found suitable, they would be given to German families to raise. The next category, this is one of those wonderful German compound words, Ausländerkinderpflegestätten. It translates to facilities for the care of foreign children, which sounds benign. But they were anything but. This is a category that really made me, you know, when I first learned of these, I think I sort of sat back from my desk and found myself something else to do for a little while. There were about 100 of these facilities, which also went by other names. Most of them were part of German hospitals. They were run by German medical personnel. And they were connected with the foreign forced labor system. The idea was that female forced laborers who got pregnant, either with another forced laborer or with a local German, would be sent to these facilities, where one of two things would happen. They would either be forced to undergo an abortion, or they would be allowed to give birth. Now, we've been finding, as we get into these in more detail, that there was more variety to the fates of these people than we thought at first. Sometimes these children would be allowed to live. Sometimes women were able to keep touch with them and even reconnect after the war and get them back. But I believe those were the exceptions. A lot of times, the infants were killed, usually through slow starvation. That is, given enough milk to keep them alive for a matter of some weeks, but not enough to keep them alive over the long term. I've had people ask me why they did it that way. I honestly don't have an answer. That's one of those things I just don't understand. Then there were camps and ghettos under the control of states aligned with Nazi Germany. Countries whose regimes were allied with Germany or collaborated with Germany had their own camp and ghetto systems for many of the same purposes. Now, this category includes sites under the control of Vichy France and Italy, including their North African colonies. Romania, Hungary, Bulgaria, Croatia, Slovakia, Finland, even Norway had some camps. The image you see here is of the Vichy French camp at Gours in the far southwest of the country. It held a variety of prisoners, including Jews, whom the French ultimately handed over to the Germans for deportation, and most of them went to Auschwitz. Now, there were further categories. We could be here for quite a while if I went through all of them. I want to emphasize that in reality, there was a lot of overlap among these places. And you may have picked up on this. Different kinds of camps held the same kinds of prisoners. And sometimes a camp's stated purpose was not necessarily a good indication of what really went on there. If I've learned anything from the last 17 years of work, it is that there's always room for exceptions. And the Germans did not run a consistent or logical system. Let's look now at what kinds of prisoners were in the camps. And I'm just going to run through some of the most important categories. To begin with, though, as a general point, we have to be aware of the importance of the concept of race within the camp system as it was important within the Nazi ideology as a whole. Some groups, especially Jews, were targets of the Nazi system purely because of who they were. Other groups, such as Slavs, might not be imprisoned solely because of their race, but once in the system, they were likely to receive harsher treatment because the Germans considered them to be Untermenschen, subhumans, people who were not racially valuable and thus not as worthy of any particular care. The prisoners who stood the best chance of surviving in the camps were those whom the Nazi regime did not categorize as subhuman, such as ordinary German criminals or political prisoners or British or American POWs. Now, starting with the categories that were present in the concentration camps, I'll go through a number of the kinds of prisoners that we see in the system. And I'm going to use this chart as our sort of guide. This shows the identifying badges that prisoners wore in the concentration camps. On the far left, you have red. This was political prisoners. These included, at one time or another, communists and socialists, uncooperative priests, army officers who took part in the July 1944 coup attempt, and anyone who spoke out against the regime. The green badges were for criminals, meaning serious offenders who had served their sentences in normal prisons, as well as some sex offenders, all of whom the Nazis perceived as likely to offend again. And what would happen to these people was they would serve out their normal sentence. They would get to the out-processing room of the prison. The Gestapo would pick them up and take them to a concentration camp, and they were put into something called Schutzhaft, which translates to protective custody. Not protective custody as we understand it. They weren't being protected from someone. Society was being protected from them. That was the rationale for putting them into incarceration again. The camp administrators in the concentration camps often used the serious criminals in leadership positions within the camp population. And they could be more brutal and ruthless than the guards because they had a position to protect. The blue patches were for emigrants, people who had emigrated from Nazi Germany to escape Nazi persecution, but had been captured when Germany conquered the countries in which they were hiding. They were considered to be disloyal, so they were often thrown into camps. Purple patches were for Jehovah's Witnesses. The problems with Jehovah's Witnesses from the Nazis' perspective were that they refused to acknowledge any temporal authority, so they wouldn't swear allegiance to Adolf Hitler, and they refused to serve in the German military. One interesting point about the Jehovah's Witnesses was that they considered their imprisonment to be a test from God. This was a test of their faith. And so they refused to try to escape. They could be sent out on labor details without guards, and they would come back at the end of the day, because to escape would be to go against God's will. The pink triangles were for homosexuals. The Nazis believed that male homosexuals were weak, effeminate men who could not fight for the German nation. They saw homosexuals as unlikely to produce children and increase the German birth rate. The Nazis held that inferior races produced more children than Aryans, so anything that diminished Germany's reproductive potential was considered a racial danger. Black triangles were for asocials. This is a particularly Nazi or even German category. This group included habitual petty criminals, some sex offenders, drunks, juvenile delinquents, and others with chronic social problems, real or perceived. Laws against some of these groups had been in effect long before the Nazis came to power, and some of them remained in effect long after 1945. Roma and Sinti, so-called gypsies, and there isn't a badge shown here for them, the Germans persecuted this group for a mix of reasons. Again, laws that discriminated against gypsies based on long-standing prejudices were in effect before the Nazis came to power. The Nazis viewed gypsies both as asocials, because they were supposedly habitual criminals, and also as racially inferior. They had their own brown badges in some concentration camps. The Nazis herded some gypsies into special gypsy camps and placed others in the more general concentration camp population. Tens of thousands of them died of maltreatment, where others were eventually sent to extermination centers. And Jews, marked by the yellow badge that was superimposed over their normal badge showing the reason for their imprisonment. These were, of course, the Nazis' ultimate enemies, people they considered to be, on the one hand, inherently inferior, and on the other, cunning and dangerous, a deadly threat to the Aryan race. Especially after a point in the latter half of 1941, theirs was meant to be a death sentence, either through direct killing or through a combination of overwork, starvation, illness, and abuse. Some of them did manage to survive the camp experience, but they were the fortunate exceptions. Okay, let me talk a bit about some other groups of prisoners. POWs. These included members of the military from Poland, France, Britain, the United States, and the Soviet Union, among others, although curiously enough, the Germans did not imprison every nation's soldiers. Soldiers from the Netherlands, for example, were never put into stalags, unless later on they showed signs of being members of the resistance. Conditions for each group varied according to the Germans' perception of the prisoners' racial worth. The British and the Americans had the best conditions on the whole. Most of them remained in POW camps and were relatively well cared for. I want to emphasize that word, relatively. These were not nice places. The thing that made the difference for most American and British POWs was that they could receive Red Cross parcels with extra food that they could consume themselves or trade with the guards for various privileges or whatever. Those often meant the difference between life and death for people who were living on very short rations. On the whole, though, there was only about a 2 or 3% death rate among American and British prisoners, which is close to the normal rate for that age group. The picture you see here is of American POWs in Stalag Luft 1. So again, this is a group of air crew who have been shot down and captured. At the other end of the POW spectrum were the Soviets. Hundreds of thousands of them were selected for murder based on racial and political criteria. They were either shot or sent to concentration camps and gassed. Many of the others died from malnutrition, exposure, overwork, injuries, and illnesses. Of the roughly 3 1/3 million Soviet soldiers whom the Germans captured in the first 6 months of their campaign, that is in the latter half of 1941, about 2 1/3 million were dead by the spring of 1942. Overall, about 58% of Soviet POWs died in German captivity. Note, too, that especially during the major advances in the USSR in 1941 and 1942, the Germans incarcerated large numbers of civilians, either together with POWs or in compounds adjacent to them, and large numbers of them died as well, but we don't have good figures for that. Conscripted laborers. The Germans imported foreign workers from every part of Europe. There were about 5.7 million of them in Germany by August of 1944. Overall, about 20% of the German workforce consisted of prisoners by the end of 1944. Now, some of them, especially those from Western Europe early in the war, were recruited for pay and lived relatively unrestricted lives. For prisoners such as the French, who were eventually forced to come from France, even then, they didn't lead particularly bad lives. Whereas those from Poland and the Soviet Union were often rounded up by force, often as part of so-called anti-partisan campaigns, and shipped off to Germany with no choice at all. And they were not much better off than concentration camp inmates. Here you see a carefully composed portrait of three Ostarbeiter, Eastern workers. They look very well fed. I don't know if this was taken right after their capture or sometime after liberation, but I can bet that most of the Eastern workers didn't look like this much of the time. Hostages. In many military and police camps, the Germans kept hostages in an attempt to guarantee the good behavior of the people in a particular locality. The threat was that if there were attacks on Germans in that area, the hostages would be shot, and this was very often carried out. And then members of the Wehrmacht, members of the German military, not people you normally think of as a victim group, but the way they were treated fits within this larger context. Soldiers who violated military regulations, sometimes quite minor ones, could be placed in a detention camp before or after sentencing. Roughly 500,000 soldiers were convicted by military courts by war's end, of whom between 20 and 30,000 were executed, and many of the rest were sent to camps. And for fully half of the soldiers who did go into camps, their camp stays were de facto death sentences because of the conditions there. Now note that these categories were not neat. There was overlap, there was confusion. There were, for example, some Jews who survived the war in concentration camps because they had been imprisoned as asocials or criminals, never identified as being Jewish, and were able to live out the war that way. Okay, our last question, but a big one. What were the prisoners' lives like? Well, the short answer is it depended. It's hard to form a complete picture that isn't cliche. On the one hand, there were some larger aspects of the camp experience that seemed to have been fairly consistent throughout the system. On the other hand, there were always local and even individual differences in circumstance, and often these meant the difference between life and death. Also, I want to emphasize that there was an enormous variety to camp experiences, even within categories. For the individual, the quality of their life or its extinction depended on a number of interrelated factors: race, nationality, prisoner category, individual skills, the kind of camp you were assigned to, the attitudes of the people in charge, and the kind of work you had to perform. Your own individual status, race, nationality, prisoner category, and skills was the basis for most of what happened to you. To a large extent, it determined where you were sent, how much you were fed, and what kind of work you had to do. Now, we've discussed prisoner categories already. I'm just going to cover a few other factors here, and you'll see the relationship, I think, with prisoner category. Work was a given for nearly everyone, and prisoners engaged in nearly every kind of work imaginable. What you see here is the Novaki forced labor camp for Jews in Slovakia. This one was actually run by the Slovak regime, not by the Germans. And this was a common fate for Jewish prisoners, was to do hard physical labor. Now, some people, through good fortune, connections, or professional skills, drew light work. They might have expertise the Germans needed as chemists or electricians or technicians of some sort, or they might be put to work as clerks. Now, here we see a chemist in a lab in the Warsaw Ghetto. This is how Primo Levi survived. He was a chemist, and he was able to find work in a lab, out of the weather, away from the guards, away from the brutality. Others worked on farms, and this could be harder work, but it also offered the opportunity for more food. And there was a great deal of variety in the fates of individual prisoner categories just within this category as well. For instance, there were French and Polish POWs in large numbers who were assigned in ones and twos to German farms. Now, we don't cover them as individual camps, but their experience could be quite positive. You had the local Nazi boss in the village saying, you've got to make your Polish laborers, you know, sleep with the pigs and eat garbage and that sort of thing. And farmers being farmers often said, yeah, whatever, up yours. This man works for me. He's going to eat at my table. He's going to sleep in a comfortable bed just like any other worker. So there was a good deal of variety that was possible there. The slide that you see is of a Jewish forced laborer pumping water on a German farm in Osterburg, west of Berlin. I don't know what her fate might have been. Chances are it was a good deal harsher than the French and Polish POWs. But there was always room for strange exceptions. So it's unclear what might have happened to her. Still, other prisoners worked in manufacturing jobs of all kinds, jobs that might entail no more than long, fatiguing hours of boredom, or that might expose the prisoners to extremely dangerous conditions, such as in foundries or chemical plants. Here you see workers in the BMW aircraft engine factory at München-Allach. This was technical work. These prisoners were probably well cared for. The Z on their uniforms, I suspect, stands for Zwangsarbeiter, or forced laborer, just to make sure that they could be identified. But they probably didn't suffer too much. Other workers, the people who had the worst lot, worked in mines and quarries, on construction sites, at rubble clearance, even bomb disposal. Here you see prisoners carrying stones out of the quarry at Mauthausen, up the so-called stair of death. And such positions usually amounted to a death sentence in fairly short order, either through accident or sheer exhaustion. Prisoners, especially concentration camp prisoners, who lost their ability to work were useless mouths, again, to the Germans, and were most often shipped somewhere to be killed. Shifts were usually 12 hours long, and rest was something that had to be stolen at great risk unless you were lucky enough to have a sympathetic foreman or site supervisor. Housing could consist of everything imaginable, from the standard camp that we can all picture, to abandoned buildings of various sorts, to tunnels or tents, to nothing at all. Maybe you remember this POW camp that we showed earlier. This was the sort of place in which Western POWs lived. The Soviets, on the other hand, especially in the first winter of their incarceration, lived in places like this. Those mounds you see are the holes in the ground that these men dug with their bare hands, and two or three of them would squeeze into one of those holes. They would try to roof them over with whatever twigs and sod they could find to give themselves some shelter from the weather. Note that this is at Wietzendorf in Germany, about 50 miles south of Hamburg. This is not some lonely little outpost out in the east. This is in the middle of Germany where there are building materials available for barracks, there is food available to feed these people, but they're being kept in conditions like this, and this is why so many of them died off. In terms of food, there was, again, some variety in the experiences of different kinds of prisoners. British and American POWs, as I mentioned, could receive Red Cross parcels, and they did relatively well. Nobody was getting fat, but they weren't starving to death either. At the other end of the spectrum, you have the Soviet POWs and some other categories, Jews in ghettos, for example, who often starved to death. In between those two extremes was a miserable mass of prisoners who received less than the amount required to sustain life over the long term, especially given the conditions under which they lived and worked. Rations might consist of a cup of ersatz coffee in the morning, a small piece of bread at noon, and a bowl of watery cabbage soup with little or no fat in the evening. At some camps, the prisoners might receive a little sausage once a week, but the quality was of the lowest imaginable. The vegetables often rotten, the bread and sausage made in part from sawdust, leaves, straw, or other indigestible substances. And in many camps, only those who could organize, that was the slang expression, some extra food for themselves, stood any chance of survival. One should note that the worst conditions in terms of food were not always the result of SS policy, as you might guess, but came about because of the efforts on the part of German industrial firms to spend as little as possible on the upkeep of their forced laborers. Now, there were many other aspects of camp life that we could go into, personnel, illnesses, punishments, air attacks, clothing, transportation, selection and killing, and so on. But for the sake of time, I'm not going to go into all of those details. I want to make sure we have enough time for discussion. But it is worth noting that most prisoners experienced more than one camp, and many prisoners experienced more than one kind of camp, more than one category of camp. We refer to a path of persecution often. You've already seen one example of this in the foreign forced laborers who, if they didn't perform properly, could go to a work education camp. And if they didn't succeed there, they would go on to a concentration camp. There were all kinds of links like this within the system. Here you see the path of persecution for one of our survivor volunteers, Henry Greenbaum, who started out, pardon my rather primitive graphics, but at number one there at the Starakovice ghetto. He was sent then to a nearby labor camp for Jews, also at number one. Then to number two, that's the Auschwitz-Monowitz concentration camp, where he was put to work on the large chemical factory that was being built there. Then he was sent on to number three, the Flossenbürg concentration camp, and he was with a group that was en route to Dachau at number four when the American army caught up with his group and liberated him. And this sort of thing was quite common. It meant that you could never be absolutely secure in a safe place. There was always the chance that you'd get shifted somewhere that was going to be significantly worse. And that sometimes, the flip side of that coin, you could get rescued from a place that was going to be fatal otherwise. A lot of it hinged on luck. Now, to close this out, I'll just say that I think we have to try to understand, to the extent that understanding is even possible, the cumulative synergistic effect of all of these different elements of camp life. For those of you here who have been through military training, for example, you have probably been cold, wet, and tired, but not starving, not beaten, and not sick at the same time, and with the knowledge that the training would end and you could return to a fairly comfortable life. This was obviously not true for most of the Germans' prisoners. Such conditions brought out among the prisoners the very best and the very worst that humanity had to offer. Some would stop at nothing, would sacrifice anyone or any principle in order to survive. And I personally am not going to stand here in judgment of them. I don't think any of us can say how we would react under those circumstances. Others, at the other end of the spectrum, sacrificed themselves to help their fellow prisoners or to resist their tormentors, while the mass in the middle just did what they could to try to get by for another day, to try to make life a little bit more bearable. Okay, that concludes my formal remarks. I'm putting my contact information up here for anyone who might want to get in touch with me after this event. I welcome your emails or phone calls. That concludes, as I say, my formal remarks, and I'll be glad to take your questions. Shelly's going to get a lot of exercise. Okay, go ahead.
When you spoke of the brothels, did they have Jewish women in those brothels, or were they mostly the other types of prisoners? That's question number one. And question number two is, I can try to address Bergen-Belsen and try to explain to me what type of camp that was and what it maybe turned into.
Okay, I'm going to ask you to come back to question number two. You might want to hang on to that for a moment. The question of whether or not there were Jewish women in the brothels is one that we've been trying to get at. The problem we have with the brothels is that there is almost no surviving documentation on them. We have not been able to write a single individual entry on a single brothel so far. And there were rumors, there are rumors, that some Jewish women were working in some of the brothels, almost certainly with hidden identities, because it was against the very most basic Nazi regulations for Aryans to have sexual relations with Jews. That said, outside of the brothel system, there was definitely a lot of sexual crime going on. But inside, I'm going to say I doubt that there were any Jews who were known to be Jews working, except, I mean, perhaps in one of the concentration camp brothels or in a forced labor brothel. And I'm hesitating only because, as I say, I have run into so many exceptions to the rule in studying this system. There was no consistency to it. And if somebody came to me with proof that a known Jewish woman was forced to work in one of these places, I'd say, yep, okay. All right. And I'm sorry, your second question was?
What type of camp and what classification does Bergen-Belsen camp fall into?
Okay.
And did it change, evolve into a different type of camp? Like you had said, some of these camps like evolved into different types.
I'm going to preface these remarks by saying that, as I often do, that being the editor of this Encyclopedia of Camps and Ghettos makes me more of an expert on encyclopedias than it does on camps and ghettos. I don't know all of the details of the Belsen camp. It started out as a POW camp. It was a POW camp before it was anything else. And then the SS took it over, and it was for a time a camp for sort of privileged Jews. I can't give you dates or explain exactly what happened to that. Eventually, it became part of the normal concentration camp system, although it had very few. I think it only had two or three subcamps. And then right at the end of the war, it became the dumping ground because it was in a place that was liberated relatively late. A lot of prisoners from Eastern camps were sent there. and the supply system broke down, and that's the source really for the most those horrific images that we've seen in the newsreels that the British took. I mean, it was always a bad place, but it became absolutely horrible in those last weeks.
There was one study by a psychology professor, I think his name is Megargee, in which he was studying how a person who obeys law orders keep on being very, very, very sadistic about the others. I think maybe you are aware, but I'm very surprised that this is part of the human nature, maybe, and not spoken about, because these are the people that accomplished or practiced the rules of Hitler and the other one. Why not spoken about that?
Well, I can say that I haven't spoken about it because the focus has been here on the camps themselves, as it is in the encyclopedia. We aren't addressing broader sort of conceptual issues. There has certainly been a lot of attention paid to the Milgram study and to other relevant psychological studies about German behavior in an effort to try to understand how this could have happened. If you haven't heard of it, I'll recommend a book, for example, by Christopher Browning called Ordinary Men, about a police battalion, a reserve police battalion that was called upon to execute Jews. It was not something they'd ever been trained or told that they would have to do, but they went ahead and did it anyway. And this kind of Milgram study works into that. To what extent can you get people to do awful things simply because someone in a position of authority is ordering them to do them? My own observation is that in the Germany of that time, this was perhaps more prevalent than in some other countries. The Germans of that time were, I think we would consider them to be extraordinarily obedient to people in positions of authority. Even then, though, there were those who did not want to take part, refused to take part, and significantly were usually not punished for not taking part. This is one of the things that Christopher Browning illuminates. So the people who did take part were either more obedient, more susceptible to peer pressure, or obviously more indoctrinated with Nazi ideology. It's one element that Browning doesn't address to a great extent in his book, and has come under a certain amount of criticism for that. Yeah, it is something that human beings are vulnerable to. And there have been indications that a lot of people, given the opportunity to kick somebody when they're down, will do so. It's something that we have to address as we look at this broader topic.
Doctor, did you say early on that some victims of the camps came from, I don't know, afar, overseas, or outside of continental Europe? Did I understand that correctly, or did I hear that wrong?
No, that's correct. I mean, the obvious case is POWs from the United States. But there was a smattering of people from all over the world who wound up in German custody for one reason or another. We're not talking large numbers here, but people who just wound up in Germany for one reason or another and were considered threats or had committed some crime or whatever it might be, who wound up in German camps.
I guess I was thinking of, and it doesn't make sense, but the Germans would have gone someplace to gather folks other than the folks coming to the theater, in a matter of war or whatever. So I couldn't understand why, how far away would you go to get people, why, and how many. But
it wasn't that kind of
circumstance. Okay, thank you.
Hi. I'm not sure if this is too far outside of your realm of study. I'm curious about the period of time before people were taken to camps.
I'm sorry, say that again?
I'm curious about the period of time before people were taken to the camps, maybe before they were even taken to the ghettos, or once they were in the ghettos, before they were taken to the camps, and they saw people around them disappearing, being taken away. What was the psychology of families and communities and people in the ghetto or before they were in the ghetto? What was the rationality? Were they rationalizing how these people disappeared, or did they know they were being taken to concentration camps? Did they know how bad it was?
So you're talking about ordinary Germans?
Yes. Ordinary Jews. That's a separate question about the community, the German community I know of, observing things happening. But I'm really thinking more in terms of people who were persecuted, the Jews in these communities, and they saw families around them, neighbors around them, just disappeared. What did they think happened to these people who disappeared?
I'll preface this by saying this really is a bit outside of my expertise. But my understanding is that there weren't a whole lot of disappearances in the early years. I mean, when you consider that the Germans started to create camps almost immediately, those early camps that I talked about. So if you were a political prisoner who also happened to be Jewish, you were in for an even rougher time most of the time than non-Jewish political prisoners. And those early camps were without any central direction, they were murderous places in many instances. But someone who was arrested for those reasons, I think their family and their neighbors would have known. You know, he was a leader of the Socialist Party. He was the Socialist mayor of our town, whatever it might be. So their fate was not a great secret, not in general terms. Also bear in mind that as the Germans created the more formal concentration camps, starting in 34, these were not secret. They were publicized, their existence was publicized by the regime because the regime wanted this deterrent effect. They wanted people to know that there were nasty places where you could be sent if you acted out against the regime. The details of what went on in there were not supposed to be known, although a lot of that got out too. But certainly the existence of these places, they were covered in stories in the newspaper, they were covered on the radio, because the regime wanted to warn people. They were not secret. So if you were arrested in those circumstances and sent off to a camp, people had a pretty good idea of where you had gone, and you know, in their own minds at least, probably understood why. Is that getting at your question?
Yes,
that's okay.
Very
surprising. Yes, sir.
My question is, with the enormity of the number of camps and ghettos, are there any numbers that you know of in terms of how many people or soldiers the Germans had to allocate to watch all these?
Yeah. I don't have any firm numbers, but I can say that they would not be as large as you might imagine. The Germans used all kinds of different people to guard the camps and ghettos. Very often local police, either in Germany or in occupied territories, they would find collaborators to work with them on this sort of thing. Wehrmacht soldiers who had been wounded or were too old and not really suitable for frontline duty. Of course, the POW camps were guarded by Wehrmacht guards. In work sites, very often the foreman on the site and some other workers would be responsible for watching over the prisoners. There was, a wide variety of people involved in this, but the overall numbers were not that great. If you have a camp, say, with 200 prisoners in it who are at a work site, and you monitor their work and then you send them into a building and lock the doors at night, it doesn't take too much to guard that. I will say, and sort of the flip side of that coin, that the numbers, by 1943-44, the numbers of unaccounted for workers, of escaped workers, who were wandering around Germany with false papers or with their real papers and just, you know, faking where they were going, was astronomical. It was in the tens of thousands. And the Gestapo was having a really hard time trying to keep up with all these people and capture them and send them where they were supposed to go. But again, the the overall personnel effort, the overall material effort that it required to have this system, not as great as you might think.
One of the killing camps, Sobibor, was there not a great escape from there and then the camp closed?
There was. There was a revolt at Sobibor. I believe there was a revolt at Treblinka as well. There were some German camp personnel who were killed. Again, I'm going to have to admit that I don't remember the details exactly of how many people got out. A small number managed to actually get away and survive the war. But the Germans did react to this very harshly. At that point, they decided that they would close down the remaining killing centers. They killed off the prisoners who were there, and they closed those sites down in fairly short order.
Let's take a few more questions here formally, and then we have plenty of time afterwards to you can talk to Dr. Megargee afterwards, but if some of you need to go, we'll let you out here in just a moment. So we'll take a few more.
So when did the U.S. military and the leadership, civilian leadership, find out about all of these camps and what was going on inside of them? And what year, when did they find out?
Well, it was a gradual process, if you will. Although it was remarkably early in the case of the killing centers. We had a pretty good idea, I believe, by mid-1942. Of what was going on. Here again, I have to confess that it's not my specialty. But word did get out fairly early to the American government, to the British government, that revealed what was going on in those places. Of course, we were already aware of the concentration camps, but we didn't attach the same significance to them that we would later on, because we were not aware earlier on of the exterminationist intent the Nazi regime had. That was what really started to get people's attention. It's the fact that they were killing people. But we were aware, I would say, yes, by mid to late 42. We didn't do much about it. There was a limit to what we could do. We were already at war with Germany. But it took some real some sort of radical action on the part of people in the Department of the Treasury, actually, to get the State Department, to get the President to make the State Department take some action on this. The State Department was pretty much a hive of anti-Semitism in those years. And so there was a good deal of conflict within the U.S. government over how to act. But eventually we did set up the War Refugee Board that tried to get word to Jews, the remaining Jews in Europe, tried to institute what measures it could to try to ensure that this program would be stopped. Ultimately, it wasn't too successful.
Thank you for your very interesting talk. My question is about the encyclopedia itself.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about what that process has been like, how many people are working, how many years you've been working on it, the scope? It's enormous, very interesting.
Okay. Well, for a long time, people would ask that question, and I would say, but it sort of depends on, you know, the levels of work that are involved. I've been on it from the beginning. I've had a few people at the museum, usually a maximum of five or six, who are helping in various ways. And then there's a much larger group of volunteers and interns and fellows who at one time or another have contributed in various ways. And then there are the people who have written a lot of the essays. I mean, we've had help from over 600 scholars at this point around the world, mostly in Europe, who have contributed in one way or another, written essays or edited things or found us photos or whatever it might be. So if you take the larger group, it's quite large, although there's been a very small staff that's been working on it steadily at the museum. Right now, there's me, there's two other editors, one of whom is sort of part-time, and a couple of researchers who are working with us in terms of staff at the museum. And what we do is we try first and foremost to find people who can write essays for us. We don't have the personnel to research all of these places on our own. So we do our best to find people who are expert on particular camps and to ask them to write for us and have them do the essays. We have a series of very basic questions that we try to get them to answer in their entries in what is admittedly a limited amount of space. When did the camp open? When did it close? Who was responsible for it? What kind of work was done? What kind of prisoners were in it? What was life like? Was anyone killed? If so, why? Were there trials of personnel after the war? That sort of thing. If we can't find people outside the museum to write the essays, then we write them ourselves. And that is the case with a disturbing number of entries. Even for volume one, which dealt mostly with the concentration camps and subcamps, about 30% of the roughly 1,100 entries in that encyclopedia we had to write ourselves. And for that, we go first to secondary sources. We hope that somebody has written a book. That's often how we find authors as well. But if we can't get in touch with an author or they can't write for us, we'll look to that book and we'll extract information from there. If we are really short of specifics on a particular camp and there's no book on it, we will dig into the archives. We have a huge archival collection from the museum, and that can very often answer some of our questions. But there is a limit to what we can do. And the way that we deal with that is to make our source material clear. And this is really a big difference between our work and a lot of the other reference works that are out there. We have primary source citations to some of the important documents having to do with each individual camp. And each entry has a source section at the end that discusses any secondary works, published works about the camp, as well as any archival collections. So that people can see where we have looked and where there still might be more information to be found, and they can then also branch out and see if there are other collections, other sources to look at. Answering your question. Please hold the microphone up so I can hear you.
Sorry. I am wondering, from the number of camps that were known after the war, the more popularly known ones, how were you or other researchers able to locate so many more thousands of them? How did you smell them out? Really, that's what it is.
Yeah. Well, in a sense, these places were hiding in plain sight. A lot of what we have done, and I couldn't give you a proportion, but a lot of what we have done has been to gather material that other researchers have been working on. For example, the team at Auschwitz, at the Auschwitz Memorial, had already done the research on all of the subcamps at Auschwitz, and they agreed to write for us. So they were very helpful in that regard. There are other kinds of camps that have been researched more or less thoroughly, and we were able to go to the authorities on those camps or go to the books on those camps and find out a good deal about how many there were and what they were all about, maybe flesh them out from there, but their basic existence was known. In other instances, it has simply been a matter of looking through the records that nobody has done that before. Among those 1,100 and some odd ghettos that you saw on the map earlier, there were about 300 that nobody had ever documented before as ghettos. Now, part of this is a matter of definition. If you think of sites where the Germans put Jews, there were some places that were barns, and some Jews were thrown in there overnight and then shot the next day. Is that a ghetto? No. At the other end of the spectrum, you have a place like Warsaw or Łódź. In the middle, somewhere down toward the lower end of that, we had to decide, well, how many people had to be in a ghetto? We really looked to see if there was some sort of internal organization. Was there a Jewish council, for example? Did it exist as a community for a time before it was eliminated? And that's how we defined it. So we had to make certain practical decisions. So this is all what fed into the growing number. We would first look in secondary sources, and very often we were surprised by that. We found that our initial estimates were, not in sync even with the work that had already been done. But then from there, we've always been able, when we look further, we always wind up finding more camps, or in some cases, different categories of camps that nobody had looked at before.
Thank you. Well, first off, thank you for the vision and the challenge and the effort that you put into this project. It really is amazing. And it's hard listening to all of this to think that it doesn't take some kind of emotional toll as well. So I thank you for your fortitude. Second, I wanted to pronounce a phrase that I know everyone in the room is thinking, which is never again. But my question is, what are the principal uses that you imagine for the encyclopedia as it emerges and going forward into the next generation?
Well, we have four main purposes in mind for the encyclopedia. One is to provide as much basic information as we can about each individual site, simply because these sites have not been described in that way before. And you heard me talk about the kinds of questions that we're asking. The second is to provide an aid to further research, and I spoke about that too, where we put in source information so people can go on from there. I'm pulling a blank here. The third, I feel like a particular political candidate sometimes. I'm going to jump though to the fourth, because actually that's where my mind is going. I think that's why I'm blanking on the third. I'll come back. Oh, the third is to let people see the system, the broader system within which these camps operated. And that we achieve through the structure of the volumes themselves. Each volume discusses a particular category or a set of categories of camps that sort of hang together naturally. So the first volume deals with the early camps and the concentration camps. The second volume with ghettos, the third volume with camps and ghettos under states aligned with Nazi Germany, and so on and so forth. That way somebody can look in a volume and they can see not just what happened at one particular place, but the other places that were related to that, the larger system within which that place existed. They can look at the Ortruf subcamp of Buchenwald, they can look at the Buchenwald main camp, they can look at an essay on the system of subcamps that Buchenwald controlled, they can look at an essay on the development of the concentration camp system as a whole. So they get some context that way. But now we come to the fourth purpose of the encyclopedia. And this is one that always, it was very powerful for me when I first sort of discovered it. In 2009, when the first volume came out of the encyclopedia, I had been thinking of it as a very academic project. This was a reference work that professors were going to use and researchers were going to use, and they were going to learn all this good stuff about the camp system, and that's all well and good. But this fourth purpose, which I call memorialization, had not really occurred to me. But after that first volume came out, we had a meeting of some of our survivor volunteers to show them the volume and to explain the project to them. And from listening to them talk, it quickly became clear to me that the academic purpose was all well and good, but this was not really what concerned them. What concerned them was that somebody was finally documenting all of the thousands of places that people suffered and died in, that were threatening to disappear from the history forever, that nobody might know about. And one of the gentlemen in this meeting who had actually contributed to volume, he stood up at the table, put his hand on the volume, he looked around at the others, and he said, "This is a holy book." And you can bet I left that meeting a very different person. I came to the museum with very little background in the Holocaust. The attachment to this project grew over time, and that was a big step in it. So that's what we're hoping to achieve.
And with that, I think I'd like to thank all of you for coming this evening and help me thank Dr. Megargee once again for speaking to us. If you have further questions, I think you'll be around here in the lobby, but to answer a few more of the questions we didn't get to.